Miss Tisdale, good to see you.
Thank you, sir.
Our clerk is late, so that's good.
For me today, yes. I don't know what you're trying to
do. Oh, don't move those.
They're blocking you, Mr.
That's
Smith.
What I was hoping.
Good big plant there. You know,
stage the shot.
Dr. Howell is not here today. He's sick, so.
Oh, so you'll be the chairman.
And I can't. My best side is this side, and you're going to get me straight on.
Conduct the whole meeting like that.
And Miss Clark is running late, so. The meeting of the Civil Service Board's regular meeting for Thursday, April 12, 2012. It is 10:07 a.m. We're meeting in the conference room of the Public Safety Complex on Setting Down Road, Cumming, Georgia. I'll call the meeting to order, and those present, Ms. Nydia Tisdale. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And we have Ms. Alyssa LaRenzie. John Blanchard, member of the Civil Service Board. Ms. Lauren Giles, representing Miles, our hearing officer, Dana Miles. We have Charity Clark, our clerk. And I'm Terry Smith, vice chairman and acting as chairman today. Dr. Howell is sick and unable to be here. Do I hear a motion for the adoption of the agenda?
I make an adoption, Mr. Chairman, for the agenda.
And I'll second that. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Have you had a chance to read the minutes, Mr. Blanchard? I have.
I make a motion that they accept the minutes.
There's a motion to accept the minutes as written. I second that motion. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes. Go into old business, and the first item under old business is a report on the writ of certiorari. Okay. For John Gooch, is there any report on that?
The report is that nothing has changed since your last meeting. We're still waiting for a notice of hearing, which would be the next step.
And while you're talking on Jeff Chance?
The same report, nothing new.
We'll go into new business then. Has anybody heard anything from Jeremy Cranford? Ms. Clark, have you heard anything from him, his attorney?
We did receive the notice of appeal and intent to file a petition for a writ of certiorari from Mr. Cranford. We received that from his attorney's office, Bonnie Jones. Of course, we filed that for the board's records. Other than that, I have not received any other correspondence from Ms. Jones or Mr. Mondelli.
Okay.
Yes, our report from our office is the same. more than 30 days have passed since your decision was made. If you have any questions about what that means, I'd be happy to discuss it in executive session because I'd be advice of counsel. But otherwise, that's really all there is to it at this point.
I don't think there's any need to do that. Okay, the next item of business is Civil Service Board Procedure 2.2.1. I would like to say this before I turn it over to Ms. Giles. After our last meeting, I was reviewing our civil service handbook, and our civil service policy doesn't allow for the appointment or what would take place in the event that somebody got sick, one of the members, either John or I, the one representing the county and the employees. There was no procedure in place should we be having an appeal. Sometimes it takes as much as 2 or 3 months before a new person could be appointed. And I called and asked our hearing officer, Mr. Miles, if he would review that and then submit a document to us to reflect a policy on that. This manual does give the board leeway to set its own policies as long as it follows the guidelines of the regulation. And he did that, and he has communicated with each one of us individually a document that he drew up and asked for if we had any opinions or changes on that. So I'll let you, Lauren, take over and explain that.
Certainly. What procedure 2.2.1 deals with is the situation where there's an interim period between when either the first or the second board member's position becomes vacant and when the position is filled by an election. Those are the two positions where an election is held, and that process just takes some time. So what the procedure calls for is for the remaining members of the board to appoint someone as a temporary member to fill the vacant position until the position can be filled by an election. The procedure does call for consideration first for the temporary member position to be given to the member of the board that the board appointed to the ethics board. But after that, consideration can go to someone else. That's just the first name that is to come up under the procedure for consideration. I have copies of it if anybody needs one.
I've got one.
I have one. Thank
okay,
you.
Great.
Make one for our
record.
Yeah, that one, we're just sure that that's okay.
You might pass one to Ms. Tisdale.
Ms. Tisdale, would you like one?
Yes, thank you very much.
And Ms. LaRenzie.
Yeah. And the way that I read this is this in no way, shape, form, or fashion is in contradiction to the policy?
Absolutely not. The purpose is just to fill what is perceived as a void in the policy, what to do in the interim period, because it does take some time to go through the election process. It can take several months to go through the nominating process, the potential for a runoff, et cetera, and this just deals with getting somebody in place temporarily in the meantime while that's taking place.
And if we have a hearing, the way I read it, even if somebody's been appointed and we have already started a hearing, that person would finish that hearing.
Yes.
And Mr. Vice Chairman, just to also add to that, I know Mr. Miles shared this with the county attorney's office as well. I did speak briefly this morning with Mr. Mondelli, and he has reviewed the policy and did not advise that there were any issues or they did not perceive any conflict with the civil service rules or state law.
Okay, so we got their stamp of approval.
Yes, sir. Okay. That was my understanding.
Is there any other discussion that needs to take place? You got any questions, John?
No, I don't.
I think it's appropriate for me that I can make that motion. Is that right?
That would be my understanding.
Okay. Then I make a motion that the board adopt procedure 2.2.1 to be added in at the end of policy 2 in our handbook. It will follow, be located on page 6 and any further pages after that. And make sure that I'm right on that.
Yes,
okay.
That's correct.
It'll be added at the end of it. I made a motion. Do I hear a second?
I second that.
All in favor of this motion, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. motion passes. Next item on our agenda is a discussion of the Open Records and Open Meetings Act that just passed the House, House Bill 397. We did ask at the last meeting that our hearing officer give us a brief overview of what that act entails. We do want to be in compliance.
Of course, yes. I have brought a handout that was prepared by the Georgia Municipal Association on the changes in that are in House Bill 397. The bill has currently...
You have extra copies?
Yes, I do have a couple extras.
Thank you.
The bill is currently passed both chambers and is awaiting signature by the governor as of yesterday, which is the last time I checked. Anywhere in this handout where you see the word council, of course, substituted board, both considered agencies under the Open Meetings and Open Records Act, so it applies equally to the board as it would to be whether it's the county or the city that the GMA is addressing in the handout. At the end of the handout, you'll see a website where you can enter that email address, or that web address, excuse me, and pull up a full copy of the bill, including all the changes. It's 55 pages long, so I didn't think you would want to sit and review it at this time, but feel free to pull it up, take a look at it, or of course you can just enter it in the Google browser and find it that way. The bill changes the definition of both what is a meeting and what's not a meeting. And those definitions you'll find on the first page of the handout. The bill talks about notice for a regular meeting. Notice of a regular meeting must be posted at the regular meeting place, and if your agency has a website, you're not required to have one, but if you do have one, to post notice of the meeting on the website as well. Notice of specially called meetings should still be provided 24 hours prior to the meeting. But they can be less than 24 hours now under the bill in certain limited circumstances if there's an emergency, certain things that are outlined in the text of the bill. The bill deals with taking minutes of the meetings, and now the minutes need to reflect both the person making a motion and the name of the person who seconds all motions. Minutes of a meeting also must be kept during executive session. However, if attorney-client communication takes place during the executive session meeting, the topic should be reported, and the fact that attorney-client communications took place should be reported, but not anything regarding the content of the actual advice or communication that took place. Meetings by phone conference will be allowed now. Previously, that was only allowed for state agencies. The board will now be able to do that in certain limited circumstances. For example, if someone is sick, I believe it's twice a year, they could participate by a telephone conference. Email communications among board members do not violate the Open Meetings Act. However, those email communications are subject to the Open Records Act. That's a little bit of a gray area in our opinion as far as what if you were communicating about a topic that would be covered in executive session, and that's something we're actually going to try to find out. At this point, we just don't know. The bill addresses executive session and what can be voted on during executive session. A lot of these aren't really pertinent to the board. They deal a lot with real estate transactions. For you, I think that the settlement of a disputed claim for which the board is obtaining advice of counsel, that's pertinent to you, and those can be voted on in executive session. But then in an open meeting, after the executive session, the terms of the settlement should be announced and another vote should take place.
Would that be the same thing as an appeal hearing?
Yes. So.
I mean, really, I guess it could be a dispute between the county and the employee.
Or if it's something, that went up on appeal, I think that would pretty much be the most appropriate circumstance where you're trying to resolve the issue during the course of litigation. A meeting, which this is obviously the most pertinent one to the board, a meeting discussing or deliberating upon the disciplinary action or dismissal of public employees is something that can take place in executive session just like before. There's no change in that. And I'm sure you'll be interested in the changes to the penalties, since those are you know, what most people want to know in your position. And those are in the handout. I think it goes from $250 fines to $1,000 fine for violation. And the fines increase for multiple violations. Not that you guys need to know that, but I know that's what everybody wants to know. The handout also deals with the Open Records Act. I won't really go into that since that's not as pertinent to your function, but certainly feel free to take a look at it. A couple things that I thought were notable was that the cost of copies went down from 25 cents a page to 10 cents a page for regular size copies. And I think it's also notable that the definition of the attorney-client privilege, what should be withheld from disclosure, has broadened to basically any communication that would be considered attorney-client privilege under state law. There's one limited exception when an attorney is doing an investigation, and it's very specific. So basically, any attorney-client communication would now be considered something that would be disclosed under the Open Records Act. So that's pretty much it.
John, you have any questions?
Nothing I can think of right now, no.
Well, I've got one.
Soak in.
I'll certainly try to answer it and do my best and do some further research.
What would we do as a board? What violations would we commit as a civil service board that would deem us being penalized monetarily?
All right, let's turn to the penalties portion. It's on page 3. Criminal penalties for violations increase from $500 to $1,000. Civil penalties can be up to $1,000. So it seems like that would be any violation of the act. I'm not sure what, as far as intent or anything like that. I haven't looked into any cases to see, you know, what situations were where people were fined. But I think as long as you're following the rules, I think it's important, especially with executive session, to be clear about when you're going in, why you're going into executive session, and to make the appropriate motions to come out, and then if any votes take place that need to be made again in public, to do that process. But
and that's why we hire y'all to do it.
Yes, sir.
Make sure we do.
And then it would also be like the proper
posting.
Public notices,
yes, of course,
and
yes,
things like that.
Well,
and
now,
it does say there's a good faith defense.
The fact, I'm not putting this all off on Ms. Clerk as our clerk, but could we be held as individual members of this board? We don't work for the county. If Ms. Clerk didn't post something the right way, could we be penalized monetarily for that fact?
I can't answer that question, except my gut feeling would be no, but I think it would be, you would be penalized, and this is, like I said, I can certainly look into it more and give you a more specific answer. But my feeling would be that your violations would be more things, if the board members were properly conducting a meeting with that, discuss board items without posting notice or something like that, where you were the ones acting, where you were the responsible party for causing the violation, I would think. I can certainly look into that, but I'm sure that it won't be a problem as far as...
No, I'm not expecting that problem. Ms. Clark's done an excellent job. I just, this act changes everything.
Yes.
We're just individuals, private citizens, mm-hmm, serving on a board. And,
yes,
we do not have the power to establish where we meet. We meet where we're told to meet. Mm-hmm. And, of course, we do have a set time to meet every month for a regular meeting.
Mm-hmm.
But Ms. Clark works for the county. She doesn't. She is our clerk, but, mm-hmm, I can't call her up and say, we're going to do this or we're going to do that, because she has other responsibilities. So
right. I think...
I'm just trying to get a handle on what,
yes,
our liability
is.
Yes, I think
that your liability would more arise in a situation where, if you decided to call up a couple members of the board and say, hey, let's go meet at McDonald's and talk about this pending case and not let the public know.
Right.
And, I think that would be more of your notice issue would be if you operated outside of what you would do anyway. You wouldn't do that. So
no.
I think that would be more, where you're the one who had the conduct initiated the conduct that led to a violation.
Okie dokie.
May I please ask a question?
Well, it's unusual, but I'll allow you to if it's not a complicated one.
No, it's rather simple. I was wondering, on cancellation of a meeting, what are the public notice requirements in case a meeting is canceled? Thank you very much, Vice Chairman Smith.
I know it's the act says you still can cancel regular meetings. I'm not sure if it covers how notice is given.
I've gone to a few meetings and I got there and found out when I arrived that they were canceled.
Right.
Yeah.
And it wasn't posted.
You're talking about the
website.
Posting of it being canceled.
Right.
You don't have to worry that, about that with us.
And I haven't. That's true.
Only when the county was closed for snow.
Well, yeah.
And that was
that would be understandable, I would hope.
It just says meetings shall be held in accordance with the regular schedule for the regularly scheduled meetings, not a special meeting, of course. But nothing in the subsection shall preclude an agency from canceling or postponing a regularly scheduled meeting. But it doesn't say how to give the public notice of that. It just says you can't.
I've been to four board meetings, and not this board, in 4 months that were canceled.
Mm-hmm. I understand that would be frustrating, but of course. I can't really give you legal advice, but I can tell you from looking at it that I don't see anything that would cover that circumstance.
Thank you very much.
Feel free to look into it further for yourself.
Okay, do we have any new appeals, Ms. Clark?
No, sir. No new appeals have been received.
We can record the county at peace?
Yes, sir. The county is at peace.
County is at peace.
Wow.
I don't think that we need an executive session today, do we, Mr. Blanchard?
No.
I don't think so. Is there anything else that needs to come up? Your motion to adjourn?
I make a motion to adjourn.
I second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Meeting's adjourned.
And our next meeting.
And well, our next meeting will be our regular schedule.
Right. May 10th at 10 a.m.
Here. Hopefully Dr. Hall will be back.
Yes.
He's sick.
Okay. Sorry to hear.
He's running 102 degree fever. Oh. His wife called last night.
Okay.
I put that in the minutes, so.
Okay.
I think you've been real good about stating who makes motions and who seconds or something.
I think, yeah, I usually do identify that. Okay. And then will you just let us know, or Mr. Miles, let us know if and when the governor passes that? So we
of
have,
course, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. We'll let
Governor signs.
I'm sure it'll be in the news. Shouldn't be too hard to track that down.
I do try to keep up with the legislative updates, but sometimes. So
yes, I'm sure they can be very overwhelming this time of year.
Okay.
Well, you guys have a wonderful afternoon.
Did you find any? Did you find any eggs? Did you hunt any eggs?
I
glad to have you.
Hey, nice meeting you.